See, sometimes I look around and I look at the Lagos two of them, and I don't recognize them. You know, even the traffic that was very a big part of my childhood, beginning to ease out of the sun. I can decide to go some places that have never been before on a big day. And one of the other things about growing up in Lagos was also the fact that I knew my neighbors, I didn't live in a gated community, I didn't have a fence, I didn't have a gate, I didn't have protocols. I could walk up to my neighbor's house, say hi to them, sleep over. But today, even right here now, I don't know any of my neighbors. I don't know who lives in the next house from them. I've been there for 4 years. And I'm pretty sure if I ask all of you, probably the same case. Another major aspect of my life growing up was football. And I remember one of the worst punishments I could get was my dad banning me from playing football for a couple of days because maybe I failed at school. Yes, someone was this way. Or I did something wrong at home and my father was not allowed to go out. It was one of the worst things. And if you look at all the things that the child is, if you grow up in Lagos, I grew up in, this was me. I'm not listening to, I'm not saying that anymore. This signified what growing up in Lagos was for me. I played football on the streets, I played football in mud, I played football on sand. And doing this probably enjoyed, I enjoyed getting me from the game. On this game, because it was a matter of a 9-year-old boy in Lagos growing up. You had to get on wounds and bruises. And I remember every time my mom, you know, when she starts to explain, you know, about, you know, really getting close to our house, like, hey, with your mama, you know, things like that. But now today, you are around, and it's difficult to kind of find football pitches anywhere in Lagos. You want to play football today. Where there is good fields and parks to play football, then you go there today, you see real estate, you see high rise buildings, you see very big malls, and they've all been replaced by things like that. And it starts to worry me because we live in an age where sports is supposed to be part of the big picture of the country. The development of a country. Growing up, I remember what vision and football meant to me. I was probably about five. But as a kid, I had a very photographic memory, and I remember seeing, I can actually see him, and I see my dad jumping when I can remember who scored the final of vision and football. I don't remember, but I remember we had this very tiny 8-inch TV. Yes, there's the 8-inch TV that we don't know. We never saw them, they're too young. And I know what it felt to go out of Lagos, and I know what it felt to be in Nigeria. Then 2 years later, this happened. Then after we go out there, I started to play football, I started to love football, I started to understand what football was. And I actually remember driving out the next day. Everywhere I went to in Nigeria, there was celebration. Everywhere you went to, there was joy. What I saw in 2013 doesn't come half as close as what we felt here. Because maybe the kind of dollars we got under them, maybe. And so the only thing that brought joy to Nigeria. So it hurts me today when I go around and I try to play football, I try to organize football. I'm met with brick walls, I'm met with bureaucracy, I'm met with a lot of stumbling blocks. They really place me the way just to do something that can bring this kind of joy to people like you and me. So, in doing this, I and my friends decided to start a life in the world in such a way that we could fix some of the things that we think are wrong in Nigeria through sports. And when I think about it, very commonly called TEDxUnilag. And I'm not supposed to promote my company, so I can't do anything on that. But TEDxUnilag is simply the number of people where guys like you, me, and girls as well. TEDxUnilag are very, socially and gender conscious. So girls like you play a lot of people who are at school and who really want to pressure you. You said that the cause. Families just need guys on Twitter. It's not a general thing. We're not a fit culture. We don't have an exercise culture. We don't have a fit culture. And in doing this, I think we started to look at how we can manage that gap between, you know, amateur football and the game structure to bring to the Nigerian atmosphere. And importantly, to I was looking at this guy, I don't know if you know this guy. You know who that is? And the picture on the left is him in 2011. He's playing for a team called Femi at the time. And in 5 years, from the age of that picture, he's the best striker in the Premier League. He's playing for England. And he's one of the best strikers in England. I didn't know he was going to kill him. But today in Nigeria, I think that the guys going to kill who I know are quite good, who are better than a lot of the guys that are in our 20 or whatever structure we have. But there is no progression. There is no chance for you to begin your career after that. You have to use means that are rather small. So, we're talking about the big picture today. What am I trying to do with it? I'll tell you. It's simple. It's a very simple thing. And I look at this and I look at what we have planned to be on the structure. And I tell people that, look, we cannot depend on a system that has failed us for years. We ourselves have also failed the management system because we just sat back and watched the game. In our nature to just say, it is that guy there to do it, it is that girl there to do it, or it's problem, it's that administration's fault. And not on that. So I think the observer is what we need to do. So we need to do that. So we want to organize this tournament because we're trying to build a platform. In doing this, there's a lot of issues, we face a lot of challenges, and biggest one is, it is not a money-spinning enterprise. So, I can't quit my day job. None of us can quit our day jobs simply because we want to organize local amateur football in Nigeria. Our dad, or our wife, or no money. So, balancing that with my 9-to-5, I mean, I'm here today because I had to go to work. Do something so that I know how to come here. I have 4 people that are nice to feel like they're going on in Nigeria at all. So the legwork and all of that is on just a few guys here in Nigeria. That's a big challenge, but something that should not be my duty, should not be my job, should not be my problem. I'm having to balance work, running to meet potential sponsors. We plan an event in Lagos. If you've ever been to an event, finally, a particular event, you realize how difficult it can be to organize. Like last year, we had organized it, paid for the venue, did all we wanted to do, publicity, and all of that. And we get to the venue that morning, and the venue is closed. Because they want to hold the rally. No permission for us. No. I mean, we get there ready to hold an event and we get to the stadium we want. And that's how we have to postpone the event for better days. Kind of events in Nigeria, you have to postpone. I don't need to tell you what kind of something and you're really doing well, and those are people that matter and care to help you out, and you get this life, and so forth. You know, you're looking for me, not only that, you're looking for local small commissions here, you're looking for state government, you're not asking for money. It's just providing X, Y, Z for us, that's all we're trying to do. But I'm telling you, just it would be like a waste of time. And I'm just raising money to organize also houses, ups and downs. Now, you go back to looking at what sports have been to Nigeria. Let me tell you, if you've not been a football fan in Nigeria, I think you went on football fan, the 90s when Nigeria is really, really good. You'll see what long term plan was. Every success we had between 94. Even to the large extent of 2000, when we lost the definition score and lost so many, my opinion, the final. Every step from what one man did in the 80s, you know, he went by the name of West Africa. He established systems, established patterns, established like a business plan. He would even call it just a young boy to put them on the pitch and get them out of the problem. He had plans, and those plans, even after he left, he were, you know, we were the benefits of those plans, but he left. Typical Nigerian platform, no plan, nothing. And so today, we have, if you go to any Nigerian agency that gives you sports and access to show you what you plan to achieve, you want to get any documentation, you want to get any, they don't know what they're doing. And it's painful, like I said, because that period of Nigeria is kind of seen like in the US. You know, I went to a public school, I went to King's College, and during that period, late 90s when I was there, you know, that World Cup, that was just what I was there. And you had to pass. But once everybody heard that Nigeria was playing, everything just comes to a halt. Even if it's for 2 hours, you're not talking to that guy. This girl, how's that friend, don't like him, this your ego friend, don't talk to him, and you all go to the common area and it's for them to watch a match. All of a sudden it's fun. And I know if you go to every single state in Nigeria, it will be similar. I served in the really top of our states when it just started. And it's simple. You go to the human center to watch a match. For that period, they don't care about the combat, they don't like them, they don't care about them. But after the match, they don't use me. They don't, it's not a problem. But you see them in that 90 minutes. Football has that effect on you. So I want you to picture this. We're talking about the big picture. I want you to think about what we can do as a system manager. Look at the US system of having schools, sport programs that are linked to secondary schools and that being primary schools. Imagine a Nigeria where, aside from the exam requirements, the school can come to the venue, hopefully the 2 year old, you see a 14 year old boy playing football, and come into parents and say, your boy's talented, I know you may not have money, but we'll take him into the University of Lagos. As long as he keeps a 2.0 GPA, he will be on the team and will play schemes. That is what we should do. It is not rocket science. It doesn't require an extensive culture or spending or whatever you are made from. It is just simply a couple of things thinking about in 10 years. Because if you look at it, for the next 10 years, I can tell you who we are top 4 or top 5 or top 6 people. It's not rocket science. I'm not pushing any company back. So you can't go one day and decide to do something great without paying a bit of it. Breaking your body weight. Everyone looks at training plans. Everyone looks at, mission goals and academic chemistry. I had to consider how come these guys are fast? What is it about the academic chemistry that they're fast? And I saw the guy from the year. I'm used to doing 5 years in the business plan. I saw a 100-year plan. What metrics they want? And you wonder why they're. Guys, look at these guys. He you want to see a perfect example of what Nigeria does to the sports, you look at how we went to the Olympics. You buy it on the phone now. 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 And then you come with the goal and one online transfer or whatever. It's obviously non-proud. It is not going to work. So like I said, now that's the strength and we have that culture there with schools, with communities. Imagine picking up everything to your local club and it's a local football match with your friends and trying to represent it. It's what keeps us there. So my last point to you guys today is, in a big future for Nigeria, you cannot ignore sports, you cannot ignore football, and you have a part to play.